Well, good afternoon and welcome to North Star Oasis. Yes, I know we're a little bit in the dark right now, but we'll get that taken care of here in just a second. I'm your host, Jeff Williams, and we're here for another week. Another jam-packed, action-filled week. However, I will tell you, we are not taking phone calls today, and we will be having a guest on. However, I'm not here. We are pre-recording this because I am at the Northern Great Plains History Conference in Bismarck, North Dakota, delivering a paper on the Great White Fleet and its impact on the two world wars. And I'm not even going to get into that one today, perhaps maybe next week or the week after or sometime in the future. But right now, we're just going to continue on as we always do. If you are a regular viewer, we do our presidential flavor of the week. And guess what? So far, this is the last one. Yes, that is right. Of all of the presidential candidates, we are now down to one. We had John Kasich last week, and this week we are going with Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker. Now, yes, we know that Scott Walker is no longer in the presidential race. However, because we missed a couple of weeks, we had to throw some reruns in, we just felt that it's best just to at least show you what should have been and what could have been, even though it's not going to be. So let's take a look at Scott Walker's announcement in Waukesha, Wisconsin.
It is official. Governor Walker is running for president.
My record shows that I know how to fight and win. Now more than ever, America needs a president who will fight and win for America.
The governor made that announcement in front of thousands this evening at the Waukesha Expo Center. The 47-year-old says he is ready to be our next president.
Our Charles Benson live in Waukesha now with the highlights from that speech. Charles?
Well, the road to the White House begins here in Waukesha for Governor Scott Walker. He came here to launch his presidential bid, the very same place where he won the recall election nearly 3 years ago. A defining victory then, as he now tries to make history again. It was vintage Scott Walker, no tie, sleeves rolled up, inside a very warm but crowded expo center.
We are so honored to have you join with us here today as we officially announce that we are running to serve as your President of the United States of America.
Walker wants to take his Wisconsin record of reforms and tax cuts on the road to the White House. It's a long road right now with bumper-to-bumper Republicans, 15 so far.
I'm for reform, growth, safety. I'm for transferring power from Washington into the hands of hardworking taxpayers in states all across the country.
The 47-year-old Republican and son of a preacher played to his hometown roots and Midwest values.
My brother and I have thought back throughout the years, and we've realized we did inherit fame or fortune from our family. What we got was the belief that if you work hard and you play by the rules, you can do and be anything.
Walker often talks about winning 3 statewide elections in 4 years, thanks to the recall. But as a Ronald Reagan admirer, Walker believes it's not just about winning. It's also about leading.
If our reforms can work in a blue state like Wisconsin, they can work anywhere in America.
Now, Walker hits the road tomorrow with multiple stops for the rest of the week as Wisconsin's 45th governor tries to become the nation's 45th president. In Waukesha, Charles Benson, today's TMJ4.
Charles, thank you very much.
And that was in July. July 13th was when he made his announcement, and unfortunately we're just getting to it now in October. But now let's take a look at his campaign ad called Momentum.
That I know how to fight and win. Now more than ever, America needs a president who will fight and win for America. To do that, we need new, fresh leadership. Leadership with big, bold ideas from outside of Washington. The kind of leadership that knows how to get things done, like we've done here in Wisconsin. America is a great country. We just have to start leading again. It's not too late. We can do it because we've done it before. And if you work hard and you play by the rules, you can do and be anything. That's the American dream, and that is worth fighting for. I'm for transferring power from Washington into the hands of hardworking taxpayers in states all across the country. That's real reform. Americans deserve a president who will fight and win for them.
Well, Scott Walker had a very good, positive message. Unfortunately, that didn't quite resonate, and we'll get into that in just a moment. But, you know, he did have one thing that was a standout performance during his short-lived campaign, and that was something that happened when he was at the Iowa State Fair. He had gotten heckled by protesters, and he gave a short but pretty effective response.
Unintimidated. I am not intimidated by you, sir, or anyone else out there. I will fight for the American people over and over and over and over again. You want someone who's tested? I'm right here. You can see it. This is what happened in Wisconsin. We will not back down. We will do what is necessary to defend the American people going forward.
Wow. He is not intimidated. He was not intimidated by the unions in Wisconsin. He was not intimidated by hecklers in Iowa. But with the rise of Donald Trump and a few other people who were sucking up the media attention, that did not bode well. And here is the results of what happened.
As a kid, I was drawn to Ronald Reagan because he was a Republican and a conservative. Most of all, I admired him because of his eternal optimism in the American people. That thought came into my head when we were all standing on the stage at the Reagan Library last Wednesday. Ronald Reagan was good for America because he was an optimist. Sadly, the debate taking place in the Republican Party today is not focused on that optimistic view of America. Instead, it has drifted into personal attacks. In the end, I believe that the voters want to be for something and not against someone. Instead of talking about how bad things are, we want to hear how we can make them better for everyone. We need to get back to the basics of our party. We are a party that believes that people create jobs, not the government. And the best way to grow the economy is to get the government out of the way and build it from the ground up. We are a party that believes that the way to measure success in government is by how many people are no longer dependent on the government, because we ultimately believe in the dignity of work. We are the party that believes that a strong military leads to peace through strength, and that that will protect our children and future generations, that good will ultimately triumph over evil. We are a party that believes in the American people, not the federal government. These ideas will help us win the election next fall, and more importantly, these ideas will make our country great again. To refocus the debate on these types of issues will require leadership. While I was sitting in church yesterday, the pastor's words reminded me that the Bible is full of stories about people who were called to be leaders in unusual ways. Today, I believe that I'm being called to lead by helping to clear the field in this race so that a positive conservative message can rise to the top of the field. With this in mind, I will suspend my campaign immediately. I encourage other Republican presidential candidates to consider doing the same so that the voters can focus on a limited number of candidates who can offer a positive conservative alternative to the current frontrunner. This is fundamentally important to the future of the party, and more importantly, to the future of our country. This is a difficult decision, as so many wonderful people stepped up to support our campaign. Tonette and I are very thankful for the many outstanding volunteers and the excellent staff who helped us throughout the campaign. You all have been like family to us. And speaking of family, I want to personally thank my wife, Tonette, who has been a rock, as well as our two amazing sons, Matt and Alex. I thank my parents and my brother, David, and his family, and all of our other family and friends for their love and support. Most of all, I want to thank God. I want to thank God for his abundant grace. Win or lose, it has always been more than enough. Thank you.
And that was Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker with a short-lived campaign. He joined the race on July 13th, right after the Wisconsin legislative session ended, and then he had dropped out on September 21st, so just about 2 weeks ago. That was not really that long of time. You know, you get guys like Jim Gilmore, Lindsey Graham, George Pataki. These guys are still in the race. But they're, you know, I think we know they're going nowhere. They're not going to rise to the top. They're not going to pull a John McCain 2007-2008 campaign. Now, if you recall, in late July, John McCain was almost was pretty much out of money, laid off staff. His campaign was going nowhere. He fired his campaign manager, and somehow, in some way, he managed to stay in the race long enough to secure the Republican nomination. But you know, I don't think Pataki or Gilmore or Lindsey Graham are going to be that way. But I think Scott Walker just demonstrated some leadership. When you say, you know what, there's a certain amount of time that comes in every campaign where you got to ask yourself, is it worth it right now? Walker's only, I think, 47. He's still a young enough guy that I expect that we'll be seeing him in years to come. He's got a bright upside, a great potential. He's really already shown to be a Republican warrior when you look at what's been thrown his way in having three elections in 4 years. But running for president takes an incredible organization, and it takes in a boatload of cash, and both are needed in order to get there. And if you're lacking in one, then you're usually lacking in the other. And I think that's what happened in Scott Walker's case. So it was a interesting time for Governor Walker as he goes from front runner to the second person out. Now, by the way, I say second person out because 10 days before Scott Walker withdrew, so did Governor Rick Perry from Texas. And let's take a look at his announcement.
Just minutes ago, former Texas Governor Rick Perry announced he is dropping out of the race for president. Speaking in St. Louis, Perry announced he is suspending his campaign. He told the crowd he has no regrets. He said the Republican Party is in good hands with the best field of candidates in a generation. Perry said he and his wife are ready for the next chapter in their lives.
We have a house in the country. We have two beautiful children. Two absolutely adorable, beautiful, smart granddaughters, four dogs, and the absolute best sunset you have ever seen from the back porch of that house. Indeed, life is good. I am a blessed man.
Well, for some in-depth perspective on this big announcement, we are joined by the host of KXAN State of Texas In Depth, Josh Hinkle. Josh, a lot of people wondering, why is this happening today?
Well, you know, CNN has its debate next week for all of the GOP hopefuls, and it actually announced the list of the top-tier candidates and the lower-tier candidates for the two debates, and Rick Perry was at the top of the lower tier. Actually, Carly Fiorina, the former Hewlett-Packard CEO, she made it into the top tier because of a rule change that allowed an 11th person in there. So, you know, after his last debate performance, which was still better than his last time around back in the last presidential run, it just didn't make sense for his campaign probably to stay in the race considering he didn't make it into that top tier.
So now that his campaign is officially suspended, who will he endorse, Josh?
Well, he didn't say anything specifically, and I don't think we'll hear anything immediately from his campaign, but you can kind of get hints in his speech. He was talking about the candidate for the GOP for 2016 needs to be someone with principles of conservatism, not celebrity. And if we've seen anything from his campaign and from him in the last debate, he was really, really, really hitting Trump hard.
You know, Rick Perry has held elected office in Texas for so long, 14 years as the governor. What is next for him?
A lot of people say, you know, he's got a lot of opportunities. Some people have said that he might be a correspondent on Fox News. Mm-hmm. Some people have said maybe there's a chance for another political position down the road, U.S. Senate. But one thing I did notice, you heard him there talking about he's ready to look at that sunset on the front porch of his house with his wife. When he stepped down as governor of the state of Texas after 14 years, he told the crowd, I'm not riding off into the sunset. He was going to start running for president, and here's talking about the sunset again, so could be finally time to call it quits.
We will see what happens. Josh, thank you very much for that perspective. Donald Trump responded to Perry's announcement on Twitter. He called Perry a terrific guy and wished him well in the future.
Well, the Perry campaign has been officially underway for only a couple months. He announced in early June after several months of fundraising and studying, but his polling did not take off. At the time, Perry was still in the middle of the pack, polling at 5% in the NBC News poll from that month. But the numbers only went down. By the time the first debate came around in early August, Perry did not have enough support to make it into the main debate. In that debate, you'll recall on Fox News, many did not believe Perry shined even in the lesser debate. Now, later that month, Perry's campaign revealed staff were no longer being paid. The paycheck started flowing again later, but the damage was done. And in the days leading up to his announcement in St. Louis, several key campaign workers in early primary states quit. Of course, we'll have a full timeline on the front page of KXAN.com.
So on September 11th, there went Governor Rick Perry. 67 more weeks, we're going to be having a presidential inauguration. We know that President Barack Obama will not be the president any longer after noon Eastern time on January 20th, 2017. But we also now know that it will not be Rick Perry or Scott Walker that replaces him. Well, we're going to turn the page just a little bit here to another topic, and that is actually solar. Well, I was just reminded that something important is going to be coming up in 82 more days, and that is Christmas. You know, Merry Christmas, everybody. It's October. The skies are starting to get darker, and that means we are getting down within the last 90 days until Christmas. So you only have 82 shopping days left until Christmas. So have you made your wish list yet? Have you, well, they don't make those catalogs anymore. If you remember, I think Sears and Montgomery Ward's used to have these really thick catalogs filled with everything you could ever want and then some. And they don't even make them anymore. Now you got to go to their website, and you can go to a bunch of other websites. So, you know, we've highlighted Christmas time for the last year. So 82 more days and Christmas will be here. But with that, with the skies turning dark earlier, that also means we're going to take one last look before we get a early blackout at solar power. Take a look at this.
The economics of wind and solar are not in January what they were in July.
That is correct. But even in July, they weren't that great. I think the issue really is people are focusing on crude oil, but really the problem with solar is, if you're looking at the natural or the fossil fuels, is natural gas. Really, you should correlate solar with natural gas, because natural gas really drives the fundamentals for solar. Solar is a form of electricity. Yeah. So it's not really crude that's going to drive, you know, the pluses or minuses of solar. It's the benefits of natural gas.
So all this that we had been reading about, you know, how solar panels were getting just cheap enough that we could start to implement them, is not that dynamics. It was never true.
It's not that it was never true, it's just that it was never as true as kind of some of the solar pundits wanted you to believe. But I think the real issue, taking a step back with solar, is Japan. Solar is a market driven by two key markets. It's China and Japan. Mm-hmm. And what Japan said recently is they're essentially handing over the keys to the kingdom with respect to demand to the utilities in Japan. And utilities really don't like solar because it hurts their overall economics. Did you want to?
Yeah.
No, I was just going to say they're disincentivized, really, to push for solar energy.
Exactly. If you look at markets where essentially the keys have been handed over to utilities, Germany, Italy, Spain, the Czech Republic, in any of those markets, when utilities have essentially been given the go-ahead to stop solar, you've seen significant declines in installations. Right now, Japan is 20% of the global solar market at 8 gigawatts in 2014. It's a 40-gigawatt market. We think there's significant demand declines coming next year in Japan, amidst a backdrop of a significant increase in capacity or essentially supply. So we think prices of solar panels are going to come down again in 2015, and that's not currently factored into street estimates.
It seems like every year we see headlines that year X is going to be the year of solar. Mm-hmm. When do you expect this global warming debate to eventually pressure these governments, Japan included, to include more solar panels?
Well, think about this. Solar is intermittent distributed power, which means when the sun's up, you get the power. When the sun goes down, you get nothing. Fossil fuel is baseload distributed power, which means you get the same amount all day. So the problem is you cannot replace baseload power with intermittent power. And I think that a lot of people don't understand that dynamic. Mm. So what's happening in Japan, right, the prime minister is actually shifting to supporting nuclear again. They're about to turn on 6 nuclear reactors because at the end of the day, you can't replace nuclear power with solar power.
And the irony is, you know, Germany, after looking at what happened in Fukushima in 2012, took this radical decision and said they're going to get rid of nuclear altogether. How do you rate that transition now that they've had 2 years put in place?
Well, I mean, Germany was the world's largest solar market 3 years ago. They were installing roughly 7 to 8 gigawatts a year. This year, they're running at roughly 2 gigawatts, so significant decline. Again, at the end of the day, the utilities in Germany have become significantly less competitive against global utilities. Mm-hmm. Solar power is among the most inefficient forms of electricity from a cost perspective. So what's happening in Germany is they're actually reducing support for solar right now.
Alternative energy's future is so tied up with government funding and subsidies. How much of your analysis is tied then to accounting for election results and handicapping everything?
It's a lot, actually. But I think at the end of the day, what we really focus on is supply-demand. And I think in 2015, you're going to see a significant shift back into oversupply, given, again, the world's second-largest market, Japan, we think is going to decline significantly. And, you know, as you know, in any commodity market, when supply is in excess of demand, price equals the marginal cost of production. The marginal cost of production for solar panels is significantly below where prices are right now. So as prices come down, the earnings for stocks come down. As earnings for stocks come down, the multiples, you know, you apply to those earnings, the stocks come down. So we think that there's big downside for a lot of these solar stocks into 15.
We know consumers lose interest in alternative energy when gas prices down, when their heating bills are coming down. Do investors follow suit?
They do. I think right now what investors are looking at is crude oil prices. But again, if you look at the R-squared correlation of the solar TAN index to crude oil and natural gas, past 5 years, it's much more highly correlated to natural gas. So I think with the big decline in natural gas recently, I think that also spells potential trouble for solar. But again, what we look at mostly is the supply-demand backdrop. Right. I just think that, you know, the fall in natural gas is just providing more impetus for our thesis.
Gordon Johnson of Axiom Capital, you're. I think I'm getting to understand something that's depressing me greatly, which is that there has to be a political solution to this. There can be no easy economic solution.
And that was Gordon Johnson with Axiom Capital Management talking about solar. Now, before I bring on our guest, I do have to make one point of order here, and that is when we were discussing Governor Rick Perry, I forgot to mention that we had covered Governor Perry on this show on August 1st, and you can actually go back to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/NorthStarOasis, and look at our August 1st issue, our episode, and that's where we have Governor Perry's announcement. So if you are interested, we've got it up. So with that, I have with us today Jim Carson from RisQuant Energy. Jim, welcome back.
Good to see you, Jeff.
And so what was Gordon Johnson telling us in all of that? Can you make some sense, layman's terms? He's talking about R-square correlation and all this factor and that index. And for those of us who do not deal with this on a daily or weekly basis, what does all of that stuff mean?
Well, first of all, I can tell you that his analysis is dead center. I couldn't have done a better job myself of explaining it in terms of the technical pieces of it and so on. Very articulate too. I thought thank you for referring me to that piece. It was really excellent. Now, one of the key pieces that he was bringing up was that the Solar market is not that closely associated with oil. It's more closely associated with natural gas. That's what I would have said myself before I even heard this.
And how is that?
Because the solar's electric generation, oil is rarely used for electric generation. It's about 2% of the generation is oil. And about 20 to 25%, depending on where you are and circumstances and so on, of the electric generation is done by natural gas. But beyond that, natural gas is more often the marginal fuel, so it's the price setter, okay. And that amplifies the importance of natural gas in the power market.
Now, one thing I haven't heard either from him or from you so far is the impact of coal and wind on the power markets.
So far, the reduction in coal and generation and the improvement in wind doesn't seem to have had the impact that people anticipated. One of the things that I do is study these markets at length. And I've done it for 17 years. And the thing that I have noted is that the relationship in prices between weather, fuel prices, and power prices has been pretty constant. It's changed some, of course, but it hasn't really been. The effect has not been as big as I would have thought, say, 5-10 years ago. That can change depending. You know, we could reach tipping points and so on, too. We have noticed that the prices in the Midwest area have become more volatile because of wind, especially the overnight prices.
Can you talk a little bit about baseload versus intermittent power? What does that mean?
Well, baseload power is basically anything that's running 24/7. It's nuclear and coal. You can call natural gas. The hyper-efficient combined cycle plants can be termed as baseload. Depends on how they're used. Intermittent means that the stuff is generated when the fuel's available, when the sun's shining or the wind is blowing, and you can't simply dispatch it when you need it. There's really a third type, and that's called dispatchable. And that means that the prices are higher, loads are higher, you can turn it on. And those are more expensive to operate on a per minute basis, but than say coal and nuclear, but those are generally natural gas plants. But they're really different kinds of power. Wind especially, it's believed that wind is displacing coal. Wind is a very expensive generation source. Coal is very cheap. Even today, it's 2 cents a kilowatt hour is the cost of. And the overnight prices are about less than 2 cents.
Now I keep hearing things about clean coal technology. Is that mm-hmm. ever going to take off?
Or what's
if you look at the stocks for coal companies right now, a lot of them are going bankrupt. A lot sure. of them are over leveraged. And a lot of that blame is being placed upon the Obama administration and their overregulation of, mm-hmm. Coal as it relates to the electrical markets. Can you explain that briefly?
Some of the blame goes to government regulation and increased regulation. More important, though, has been that the market dynamics have changed. Price of natural gas is much lower than it used to be. It's less than $3 per million BTU, whereas back in 2008 it was, as high as $11-$12 per million
wow.
BTU. It's dropped by three quarters from the peak to where it is today. The dynamic that's driving the coal producers and the coal generation plants out of the market is true economics. The piling on by the EPA is not helping at all. Now, there's also, keep in mind, there's a regional division in the United States. Eastern coal is what's being harmed. The western coal area, which we're in, which Minnesota is part of.
That'd be Powder River Basin.
Powder River, PRB, and also some of the lignite in North Dakota. The economics are being pressured, but not to the point of bankruptcies. You don't see that. You don't see the bankruptcies as much. The bankruptcies are all eastern companies that depend on Appalachian coal.
Okay, Appalachia is the Bay
yeah.
Area.
That.
What about the Illinois Basin? I know there's some coal in Illinois.
Yeah, the problem with Illinois coal is that it is very high in sulfur, and it's and that's where clean coal technology comes in. Clean coal always referred to sulfur. You use and the reduction of the sulfur emissions from a power plant. That stuff's poison. And Western coal is quite low in sulfur content, and we've been doing a lot with the technologies towards improving the sulfur dioxide emissions from a power plant. That's where smog comes from. Also, okay. Nitrogen oxides.
Well, getting back to solar, we got a video we're going to play on invisible solar cells that could power skyscrapers. And this, I guess, is emerging technologies. So let's take a look and see what we've got.
There's really only one renewable energy source that can power the whole world right now, today, and that's solar energy. There's more than enough solar energy hitting the Earth to power the Earth many times over.
We're all familiar with the story of solar technology. Limitless potential, somewhat disappointing results. One of the big hurdles is where to put it. In the places where we most need power, there isn't a lot of space for big, heavy, opaque panels. Of course, if you could make solar cells thin, light, and transparent, you could put them almost anywhere.
So this is actually a solar panel that you're probably familiar with. Been around for decades. And what this does is it absorbs the light that hits the surface, and it converts that light into electricity. So here's an example of a transparent version. So this is a transparent solar cell.
Yeah.
You may.
Yeah. Okay.
We're commercializing what we call a transparent solar cell. It's really just an invisible film that you can put on any surface. It can go on a mobile device display, it can go on a building window, and it can generate energy on those surfaces. Our vision was really that we want to integrate solar technology into the products and surfaces we interact with every day. The idea of transparency kind of has risen to the top as something that seems to have a lot of value for a wide range of applications.
In the past, people tried to make solar cells transparent by shrinking down the size of the components, but that only gets you so far. Ubiquitous figured out that the key to a truly transparent solar cell isn't the size of the parts you use, but the kind of light you're trying to absorb.
We've designed photoactive materials that let visible light pass through, but can selectively harvest the parts of the solar spectrum that we can't see with our eye, namely the ultraviolet and the near-infrared parts of the solar spectrum. And so we can have a very transparent solar cell.
You're not capturing the visible light. Presumably that is affecting the efficiency of the panel to some degree.
Yeah, if you look at a traditional solar cell, it absorbs light in all parts of the spectrum. Of the light that hits the surface, 33% of that light is converted into electricity. With a transparent cell, you cut out the visible part of the spectrum, but you can still achieve up to 22%.
With our pilot production facility, we expect to be able to reach around 10% power efficiency.
Which is a drop, but then I suppose there are advantages to having things that you can see through as opposed to things that you cannot.
Absolutely. Now you have a lot more surface area that you can apply solar technologies to.
The first place Ubiquitous wants to put its solar cells is on the displays of mobile devices, which could mean the smartphone of the near future never runs out of batteries. But the real potential of a technology like this becomes clear when you start to think big, like skyscraper big.
Currently, there's a huge amount of surface area in the vertical space of buildings that's unused for energy harvesting. Utilizing transparent solar cells to convert those windows into solar panels is a way to utilize that surface area for energy generation. So now you're not just constrained to these types of devices on the roof, you can actually use the vertical area of the buildings as well.
We see this as really being deployed everywhere, generating power in the background without you even knowing that it's there. This won't be the only solution that we need, but we see it as being a very important technology to make a more sustainable society.
Well, before we take a look at or have a discussion, I'm with Jim Carson of RisQuant Energy. Jim, to conclude our coal discussion, okay. Isn't high sulfur coal from Africa part of what feeds China's power plants?
I'm not sure about Africa, but yes, the Chinese are using high sulfur coal. I think actually some of the Illinois coal might be ending up in China.
Really?
We export coal, yeah.
Okay.
I think we export the bad stuff and keep the good stuff. So, I mean, I don't know. I'd have to look at the deep into the numbers to see where the stuff's going. But, yeah, the Chinese are actually using a lot of high sulfur coal. They're not at all careful in how they're treating their environment.
And then one other question just about China in general, mm-hmm. and that is last month we had pretty much a economic collapse or mini bump down, appearing to be almost recessional in nature in China, weakened demand, weakened yuan. How does that impact what's going on in the energy markets?
Well, it's a pretty good indication that we're going to see a decrease in Chinese use of, in production and stuff. They're going to start dumping products on the market. You should see some really good deals. The solar market, panel market, I think you'll see fire sale, but continue to see fire sale prices. It's actually, I think the first recording showed that panel prices are actually below the cost of production. The average cost of production, they're actually pricing it at the marginal cost of production.
Wow.
Which is really bad. They're just basically dumping the stuff. And that's one reason why you're seeing solar panels so cheap. Start saving your nickels to get some good deals.
So you can get some good deals on solar panels.
Oh, yeah. Right now is a good time to buy.
Okay. So now, Ubiquitous Energy, founded in 2011, is a spin-out of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and comprises professionals with both technical and business experience that extends deep into the field of thin film electronics, photovoltaics, and energy. And I'm just actually looking at a story from a year and a half ago that Los Angeles-based River Horse Investments led the financing with oversubscribed participation from a syndicate of investors to the tune of $5.8 million in financing. So between seeing that...
Million or billion?
Million, M.
Okay.
So $5.8 million in financing to kind of get this thing launched.
That's nothing.
And well, of course it's not nothing. But at the same time, you've seen what they're trying to get through. Obviously, it's not there yet. But does this look like it's got potential for being something really big down the road?
I wish I could get paid for saying stuff like they're saying, because it's nonsense. Okay, let's just cut it up a little bit.
I would appreciate it.
They're talking about putting this glass technology onto your laptop or on your iPad or phone, whatever.
And the phone is in your pocket most of the time.
And
right?
Who uses their phone in the sunlight? Because the glare, you're never going to position yourself so that it's actually got a good angle. Not going to happen. You use your phone in the shade so you can see it. You don't set up your phone so that you can. It's going to collect sun. If you want extra energy, take one of these. It's a battery.
Battery.
Yeah, it's
okay.
A 10,000 milliamp hour. Battery that can give me, a lot of, I can make my iPad run for a couple days on that.
Can you take a look at that a little closer here?
Sure. I bought it for traveling, actually.
So I'll just hold it up a little bit to the camera here. So this is an extra battery.
Yeah, you just plug your
just
USB.
Just in case you haven't seen one of these.
Yeah, you can buy them, but this is $20. You plug your USB into there, and you can go anywhere you want. It's just have to recharge it, and if you have a little bit of a problem with your phone running out of juice at say 7 o'clock in the evening, have one of these in your glove box.
Now, with that, they had shown obviously the cell phones that we were just discussing, but that just brought me back to thinking about the old solar calculators that I used to have back when I was in high school and junior high, and they had that little bar up on top where the sun or the light would hit it, and then it would power it on and off.
Well,
is this kind of like that?
Same idea, keep in mind back then that rechargeable batteries were hard to come by. They were expensive and actually kind of dangerous, you kind of needed it. To make the thing work in environments where you couldn't operate it. Today we don't have that problem. You can recharge a battery. Everything's rechargeable. You just plug it in and you're ready to go. Or you have something like this to help you get through those bumps. Same idea. different operating environment that you're trying to do it in. Doesn't work. The buildings, though.
That's what I was going to ask next.
Yeah, that was a hooter. Think about this. Okay, let me give you an example of something that's being built right now. The stadium, downtown Minneapolis. We're building this big building. Let's say they put solar panels on it.
And not the reflective glass inhibitors right. With the bird stuff.
Right. Let's say that they were going to put solar panels on that building. Cool. First of all, and you do it on the south-facing side, the angle of the sun is going to be, change over the course of the day, so the efficiency is going to be much less than if you have the tracking style of solar panel. The second thing is, though, there's this little problem that right now you don't have anything blocking it, but in a couple of years, Hennepin County Medical Center is adding an addition on, going to be a building there that's going to block it. Think about the fact that the glass that's in your downtown areas is often shaded by neighboring buildings. It's just it's not an idea that's going to work. Because of that, your capacity factors are going to drop from mid-20s to mid-teens because of the fact that you can't track the sun with fixed in place glass, and you're going to have shadows and all sorts of things like that going on. If you're going to do solar, it's better to have a flat roof like a suburban plant. Like a 3M or something like that, or General Mills headquarters or something like that, where you can actually put in a real solar installation and you can. If that floats your boat.
Does this technology have any type of viability that you can see in the future?
I mean, I'm interested in it. I'll take a look at it to see if there's anything going on. But imagine you have a military background. Let's say that they wanted to put this onto the roof of a Humvee for a military application. Sounds cool, right?
Sounds cool.
Except for the fact that if you want power in a Humvee, you just plug your stuff into the cigarette lighter. Yeah, there's other solutions that are much easier to do, much, much cheaper. And, it's not cool to plug it into the cigarette lighter, but it's the way you do things. I think that the place where you will see some application for this is military. That they have some need to have portable generation way out there in the boondocks.
Especially the desert climate.
Desert climate or wherever you don't have power, local power. That makes some sense. Or if you've got, let's say you've got a remote installation where you need to power like a weather station or where you can't bring in grid power to it. You have to generate the power locally. Makes some sense there. But that's such a tiny, minuscule part of the market that I don't see it as. So it certainly doesn't support the kind of activity that was indicated there. Mm-hmm. Like I said, I wish I could get paid for saying stuff like that.
Well, let's take a look at another video coming up on a similar but a little bit different type of solar cell technology. This is coming out of Australia. And again, we'll see if this has any type of potential future viability.
Melbourne researchers have successfully created Australia's largest and most flexible solar cells with the aid of a new printer located at CSIRO. The scientists are part of a collaboration between research and industry partners called the Victorian Organic Solar Cell Consortium, VICOSC. This was achieved through the collaboration between the University of Melbourne and the Bio21 Institute, CSIRO, Monash University, and industry partners including BlueScope Steel and security printing firm Innovia Security. In just 3 years, the consortium has gone from making cells the size of a fingernail to cells 10 centimeters square. They are now able to print organic photovoltaic cells the size of an A3 sheet of paper.
The consortium is now leading the world in the ability to print solar cells and using different printing technologies. But this is the beginning of the story. We're still developing the technology, still developing the materials to enable us to print in a number of different ways for different applications.
The new printer can roll out 10 meters of solar cells per minute, which is equivalent to producing one cell every 2 seconds. Using semiconducting inks, the researchers print the cells straight onto paper-thin flexible plastic or steel.
So what we're looking at is how can we use this technology in the short term? how can we print solar cells to enable advertising? Can we put, you know, solar cells onto advertising material in shopping centres to drive an active display? So if somebody wants to advertise something with nice flashing lights, then at the moment they drive that with batteries.
In the longer term, we see these materials being able to be coated onto buildings, into windows and on roofs to provide power in a wide variety of locations and circumstances.
As part of the consortium, graduate students working alongside scientists are involved in training and development programs to improve the technology in the long term.
We're now right up there with the rest of the people in the world, but we've also got a facility which is different. We now have a process through our collaboration where we take things from the very, very beginning, from designing materials, from making devices in the lab scale, right through to the large scale printing, which is very, very unusual in the world context.
What we're doing truly is additive manufacturing. We're taking simple substrates, such as plastic or steel, and coating them and turning them into solar cells. This is what a factory of the future looks like, and it's based here in Melbourne's emerging manufacturing precinct.
Moving forward, Australia will potentially be one of the largest organic solar cell printing facilities in the world.
Well, we're with Jim Carson with RisQuant Energy. Jim, your thoughts about that?
I think the technology's got legs. I think it looks to me like the cost, I didn't see here any cost numbers, but it looks to me like given the way the process style technology, they could reduce the cost enough that it might start looking like it might be effective. It might be an effective way to produce solar generation plants. That having been said, there's still a lot of other problems with solar that need to be addressed. The one thing I noticed that is really interesting is that this printed technology does not require the heavy structure to build it on, where it's quite lightweight.
Yes.
And that'll change the dynamics of the overall cost a lot. And you could see.
So right now, is that what a bulk of the expense is? Is just the type of technology that's being used?
The technology
is construction materials.
Yeah, the technology is heavy, so it takes a fair amount of structure to put it on. You can start stapling this to simpler structures. It'll reduce the cost a lot. There's more to the generating solar. Or a solar panel than just simply the solar panel. There's also the stuff that goes with it, the construction costs and the inverters that go with it.
And can you quickly discuss about the reliability and lifetime of the Chinese solar panels that you were mentioning, the ones that are pretty much being sold below cost right now? And then also about the need for cleanliness on the surface of the panel.
Well, I think we're very greatly underestimating the maintenance costs of these solar panels. NREL, National Renewable Energy Laboratory, estimates that the cost for a utility scale is about a penny a kilowatt hour for to maintain solar. That's just expenses that come off the top.
Wow.
It's a lot. Actually, it's considering the stuff that is only worth about 4 or 5 cents on the wholesale prices.
What's the life expectancy of a solar?
See, the engineering studies say, 15, 20, 25 years, but what we don't really know from a practical standpoint in a Minnesota winter, in a Saudi Arabian summer, what's the effect? What does a sandstorm do to it?
Good point.
That we really, you have to have experience, the engineers can give you an estimate, but an estimate is just that, an estimate.
Let's take a look at one last video. We're going to take a look at why Hawaii solar industry is at a crossroads. And for our producer, that's number 21. I put these clips in order, but this is one of those where if we get to it, we'll play it. So number 21 on our list. Why Hawaii solar energy industry is at a crossroads. And I think this kind of blends a lot of the different things, including some of the local, the common problems going on right now, all blends it together into one package.
Mm-hmm. They're everywhere on Oahu, on the roofs of businesses, libraries, and one house after another. The amount of rooftop solar now accounts for 12% of the electric utility's users, and that's more than 20 times the national average, by far the highest penetration of individual rooftop solar in the country. But in this tropical state, with a combination of sky-high energy prices, abundant sunshine, and federal and state tax credits, makes going solar a no-brainer. The very popularity of these panels has become a problem.
So we drive up and you have these lovely solar panels on your roof. How's that working out for you?
It's not.
Not working out, because by the time aircraft mechanic Carlton Ho joined the rooftop solar parade in September 2013, there were so many people in his area that had installed panels that the local utility company told him and many others, don't turn on that switch yet.
So it's just a question of turning the switch on.
Yeah.
And you have juice.
Yes.
From your own roof.
And everything's awesome.
But it's not that simple. When you install solar panels, you're still reliant on the local utility. When it's dark or when the sun isn't shining, you need the grid to provide electricity. Even so, solar customers have a fundamentally different relationship with the utility. Because when the sun is shining, any extra energy their panels generate is supplied back to the grid. That earns a credit, further reducing their electric bills. In some sections of Oahu, with so many homeowners going solar, the utility said the safety and reliability of the grid could be threatened, and it slowed to a crawl the approvals of new systems.
We made a lot of progress, but we know there's still more to do as we increase rooftop solar.
Colton Ching is Vice President for Energy Delivery at Hawaiian Electric Company, or HECO as the utility is known.
What was happening was that power, which normally flows from the grid to our customers, were now beginning to flow back into those substations. Substations which were not 30, 40 years ago designed to operate in that manner.
In addition, HECO had a hard time measuring all that solar.
So right now we don't know exactly how much power rooftop solar is producing at any given moment.
So you can't see at all what a 10 to 12% of your customer base is providing?
We cannot. We cannot see that.
But while HECO studied the problem, homeowners like Carlton Ho were left waiting. In his case, waiting for a year and a half while his system sat unused.
It's got to be frustrating.
Yes. Like, you come home, you look at the panels on your ceiling, and you know you can't do anything with it. The bill comes every month. You know you got two bills because I still have my the financing. I have to pay for it. I have my electric bill. So
Ho was left to pay his regular electric bill, around $150 a month, plus another $240 a month in payments for the $23,000 solar panels that he'd bought but wasn't permitted to use.
Hawaiian Electric needs to and has taken steps to work with our customers to find solutions that works for them and works on the grid. And we haven't been perfect. It hasn't been a perfectly smooth process.
There have been some ugly moments, frankly.
There's been some very, very tough moments. It's been learning moments for us within the utility.
And for the solar industry, which took a big hit when the utility slowed new approvals. There were hundreds of layoffs and stockpiles of solar equipment. But those solar customers waiting to turn on their systems or even get permission to start construction knew that going solar would still be a good deal. A system up and running would reduce their energy bills dramatically. In the meantime, non-solar customers, still the majority, were paying much more to maintain the public grid than those with their own panels on the roof, a disparity that HECO suggested could be unfair.
It makes sense that everyone who uses the grid should pay their share to maintain and improve it because everyone benefits from it.
HECO says that non-solar customers have in a sense been subsidizing those with rooftop solar when it comes to keeping the grid humming. A cost shift estimated at more than $50 million. All these problems, delays, questions about grid reliability, and fairness could soon be seen all across the country as the penetration of rooftop solar continues to increase. Solar panels are no longer just for Sunbelt states. Even the White House had panels installed last May.
Over the past few years, the cost of solar panels have fallen by 60%. Solar installations have increased by 500%.
But rooftop solar on a massive scale has consequences that are still being measured.
These states on the mainland will eventually be having to deal with some of the issues that we're dealing with here.
Dr. Marco Mangelsdorf is a solar contractor who also teaches energy politics. Hawaii has been called a postcard from the future because of how much rooftop solar is already out here.
We are on the new frontier in Hawaii as far as trying to come up with a practical, safe answer to a very, very difficult question, which does not have a definitive answer.
Namely, just how much rooftop solar can the grid accommodate? And while delays for rooftop solar customers have angered many in Hawaii, Mangelsdorf argues that the caution shown by the utility is understandable.
You cannot allow a free-for-all, anybody and everybody, to connect to a utility grid without any type of requirements or monitoring. Just as you can't have anybody and everybody get on a freeway with a bicycle, with a horse, with a buggy, with a moped. I mean, the utility grid is a public good, public infrastructure that must be maintained.
But some say delays in approving rooftop solar are less about prudence than about profit, and about preserving the utility's century-old business model as a monopoly.
The problem is that they inherently don't want to see more of this rooftop solar, and yet they're also arbiters of what power can come on or what's reliable and what's safe.
Robert Harris is director of public policy for Sunrun, another solar contractor. He says that utilities are cautious by nature, but that they can't ignore the changing landscape around rooftop solar.
The comparison would be, you know, like, for example, the typewriter industry trying to stop computers because they want to preserve their own business model. And here, you argue that there's a better model out there that's going to be cheaper and cleaner. You know, we need to be working hard and trying to make that work better, not just trying to stop it.
Did HECO fail in some fundamental way to see the future?
I don't think we failed. I do, in hindsight, I do believe that we could have seen it sooner. But we are undergoing a literal transformation process as we speak. It is this change in relationship and change in the compact between a utility and its customers. It's no longer the monopoly utility that's making all of the decisions and passing it down to its customers.
HECO has approvals for these systems moving.
All right. Well, in the last couple of moments that we have with Jim Carson with RisQuant Energy, Jim, your thoughts about what you just saw there with HECO and the rooftop solar?
I wish we had an hour to do that one. The problem, it encapsulates some of the problems and issues that you have with this move towards solar. First of all, let's start with the fact that Hawaii is a special case. It's an island and island environment, and so you don't have the same kind of economics on generation. The generation costs are much higher there because they do rely on fuel oil for quite a bit. So prices are three times, four times what they are here on.
So they don't rely on coal over there. They can't.
Yeah, they have some. There's some coal, but it's not like it's mostly it's not. Okay. It's portable fuels. So the economics are very, very different in Puerto Rico. Or in Puerto Rico and in Hawaii, for that matter, too. The second thing is they're talking about, well, the utility is unwilling to adapt. Well, the fact is that the utility is living in a regulatory environment that compensates them and allocates costs across their system. They're not in a market environment in Hawaii. There's no markets there. And so they're to blame them for the fact that they're raising problems about this is to, you know, ignore the fact that the problem is the regulatory environment, not them. The utility industry has gone through massive changes in the past 20 years regarding markets. 20 years ago, they went kicking and screaming into the market world, and they've adapted.
So. And with that, what we're going to end up having to do is spend a whole hour on that, just not today. I'd like to have you back on, and we'll take a closer look at Hawaii's energy industry, and then we'll take a look at Puerto Rico and a few others, and we'll start making sense of this to all of our viewers. If anybody wants to get a hold of you, do you have a website?
RisQuant.com.
Spell it, please.
RisQuant. Very boring site if you're not into the electric power industry.
All right. Well, that's our show for this week. I'm Jeff Williams. We'll see you next week.